I thought that let me go into history as to what sort of clinical situations where ICG angiogram. Now you have multimodal imaging, you have fluorescein, you have ICG, you have OCT, and many diseases today the SD-OCT acts as a very good biomarker to reach a diagnosis for many, many diseases. So invasive angiography probably, you know, is more for understanding the vascular status like fluorescein angiography in diabetic retinopathy. But in macular disease, I think OCT has really made a remarkable change as far as we are able to reach a diagnosis, etiological diagnosis as far as the disease is concerned. So there are two reasons. One is the cost and the utility. Probably it's useful in centers where they have a high volume medical retina practice, where they see a large number of patients, so they need all the gadgets so that they make a proper diagnosis and treatment. The cost is always a factor as far as ICG angiography is concerned, because it, I think it adds on another 15, 20 lakhs as far as the imaging system is concerned. So in our center, mainly what are the two important indications? One is the wet age-related macular degeneration, and the other is the pachychoroid spectrum. These are the two situations where we do the ICG angiogram. So I just thought that let me see as to how much of ICG do we do in a year. Surprisingly, in 2019, we did less ICG angiogram than what we did in the previous 2 years. So that has been a little drop, although the number of patients probably are more or less the same. So the reason is, as I told you, SD-OCT is giving us a lot of biomarkers to tell us to reach an etiological diagnosis, which probably was not possible earlier. And repeat ICG angiograms probably have decreased a lot, because earlier we used to do a lot of repeat ICG angiograms after treatment just to see whether, for example, in a polypoidal disease, you would give a PDT, and after PDT, we repeat the ICG to see whether there's a total closure, etc. So I'll be showing you a few cases as to situations where probably an ICG angiogram is very, very useful. This case number one, this is a 64-year-old gentleman who actually had a history of central serous chorioretinopathy, multiple attacks, who later came to me with a defective vision in the right eye. If you see the right eye, he's got a serous macular detachment, and he has got these nice something what we nowadays call as pachydrusen, where focal areas of RPE changes. And the left eye also has got what we call as a pachychoroid pigment epitheliopathy. You see all these drusenoid changes in the parafoveal area. The right eye has got a serous macular detachment, very classic to tell you that it is a central serous chorioretinopathy. But when you do the OCT, you must always do the OCT in the full macular cube. And you see this small area of RP elevation, what we call as the double layer sign now, telling us that probably this is not a classic case of a central serous chorioretinopathy. The left eye, of course, is dry, but then he has got a typical PPE picture. So if you look at the autofluorescence again, it looks like a central serous chorioretinopathy. You can see this area of increased hyperautofluorescence here inferiorly. And therefore, an ICG angiogram was done, basically because the SD-OCT told us that this probably is a case of a neovascular membrane under the retinal pigment epithelium. And if you see the ICG angiogram, you can see the polypoidal disease. You can see this huge network of vessels with a polypoid increase. Therefore, this is a type 1 neovascular membrane, which is beautifully diagnosed by ICG angiogram. Today, if you have the OCTA, probably you can diagnose it. But OCTA, again, is a heavy investment. So with an ICG angiogram, you're able to diagnose it. If you see the fluorescein angiography in the same patient, you don't see the network at all. You see some areas of increased hyperfluorescence. But then the ICG angiogram shows you the network. And if you pass the OCT through that, you can see this polypoid change also. Therefore, ICG angiogram in this particular patient were very useful to reach a diagnosis of a type 1 neovascular membrane. This is the second case which I want to show you. The left eye has got very poor vision with a lot of lipid in the retina, and the right eye had a defective vision. This patient also, you can see here, there's a serous macular detachment and a slight elevation of the retinal pigment epithelium. Here also, the autofluorescence is more suggestive of a central serous chorioretinopathy, the descending tract in the left eye. But then the OCT and the ICG angiogram tells you that this is not a case of a CS here, but you can see these again and huge network here right in the center. You can see the network in a larger mesh. Unfortunately, the light in the halls are really disturbing the images. You see a large network here which is diagnosed by ICG angiogram. ICG angiogram becomes necessary, especially if you want to do a photodynamic therapy, because you need the size of the lesion, and the size of the lesion cannot be estimated using the SD-OCT. It's very difficult. So if you want to actually estimate the correct size of the disease, you can see here in this picture, this is a network ending in small polypoidal dilatation. Therefore, this is again another clinical situation where ICG angiogram was very useful to reach a diagnosis and also plan the treatment, especially if you're planning photodynamic therapy. Now, this is a patient who was referred to me as a succinate maculopathy. You can see so much of lipid here. Of course, people like us, me, Raja, and all, when we look at such a picture, we practically know what we are dealing with, especially when you see this orangish elevation here. So here also, you can see the OCT is diagnostic. Once you see this OCT today, you know you're dealing, you have got a serous macular detachment, you have this elevation here, you have this large PED, you're dealing with a polypoidal disease. You don't need to do an ICG angiogram to reach a diagnosis in such a situation, especially if you're doing anti-VEGF treatment. However, in our center, we did the ICG angiogram, but then this is a clinical situation where probably you may be doing only an anti-VEGF injection because you have such a large network with a very poor visual acuity. You're not going to do any invasive treatment like PDT at all. So you're going to treat these patients with injection. Probably in this situation, without an ICG, you can start the treatment and you know that this is a case of polypoidal disease and you can treat the patient accordingly. This is a very interesting case. This is a patient, again, and a very old patient of mine, one eye, very poor vision, lost for follow-up. She came to me with defective vision in the left eye. You can see the left eye, now the earlier OCT, long time back in July 2013, and the left eye, how it was. And later, when she came to us with a recent onset of defective vision, you can see the small subretinal hemorrhage and a small and large amount of fluid here in the macula. And this is a very characteristic finding in SD-OCT again. Of course, the SD-OCT gives us a clear indication what possibly is the etiology as far as this disease is concerned. For a general medical retina specialist, probably all of them fall under the category of a wet age-related macular degeneration. But from a very specialized point of view, you want to know whether it is a polypoidal disease, whether it's a type 1 CNVM, whether it's a RAP, retinal angiomatosis proliferation, because these are all things that tell us, prognosticate the patient as far as talking to the patient, telling the patient what exactly is going to be the sequence of events over the next few months. So if you see the ICG angiogram, it's very diagnostic. You can see the small area of hyperautofluorescence that is coming right in the center of the pigment epithelial detachment, which is continuously increasing. You can see here that it has increased so much more. This is a typical case of a retinal angiomatosis proliferation where we see a hyperfluorescence or a hypercyanescence, which is continuously increasing through the angiogram, right in the center of the pigment epithelial detachment. In the fluorescein angiogram, you just see a leakage at the edge of the retinal pigment epithelial detachment. But if you see the ICG angiogram, it is diagnostic. And if you pass the OCT through that, you can see this particular discontinuity of the retinal pigment epithelium where you are having the growth, the intraretinal thing is entering into the subretinal space. This is very diagnostic as far as ICG angiogram is concerned. My last slide, this is on the left, is the normal ICG angiogram where you see the tapering of the choroidal vessels as we reach the fovea. And this is a pachychoroid disease where you see these large dilated vessels right in the center of the fovea. This is very diagnostic of a pachychoroid spectrum, which again can only be diagnosed or estimated with the ICG angiogram, especially if you want to do a PDT treatment in some of these cases. My last case here, this is a patient with a long-standing serous macular detachment. FFA did not show any leak. We did an ICG angiogram, and you can see here a focal area of dilatation, or whether it's a small area of neovascularization, we do not know. But then this can again be diagnosed only by ICG angiogram in a patient with a chronic central serous chorioretinopathy like disease where the fluid doesn't go at all. When you see these focal areas, you can just treat them with a little bit of a PDT, which is very effective. You can see the OCT going through that particular area. You see the irregularity of the retinal pigment epithelium also. So I have shown you a spectrum of cases where the ICG angiogram was useful to reach a diagnosis and also probably helpful to a certain extent to reach the treatment. So to answer the question as to is it more spoken than done, probably in centers where, you know, you have a large volume of patients with multiple diseases, yes, ICG probably even today is quite a useful investigative modality, especially if you want to do a PDT. I think it is a must because the size of the lesion cannot be estimated otherwise. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Giridhar, for this excellent presentation. Do you think that in the ICG there is a drop in your institute you mentioned? Is it because only of the re-ICG which you are not doing more often at this time, or is it new case?
I don't know. I just got this data day before yesterday, because there's a sudden idea that struck me just before I left my place to reach here. So why not we just get a statistics as to how many cases? Because I asked him whether we have done any Indian survey. I mean, to find out how many of the ophthalmologists or retina specialists in India are doing ICG angiogram. Unfortunately, we do not have that data. In the United States, see, what we do, we follow the West, unfortunately. Now, in the United States, they don't do ICG because it's not reimbursed by the insurance. So they don't do ICG. Whereas, you know, that's the reason. It's not because it's not helpful, but then that's the reason why it's not done. So the drop, I'll have to go back and study as to why that was a problem. I really don't know. But I personally feel it's one of the reasons of the repeat ICG.
That's still useful. But the other survey which we actually did was among all the new VR fellows who have just completed. We asked them how many of them had an exposure to ICG angiography. More than 50% of them had mentioned that they have experienced ICG angiography interpretation during their fellowship, probably because a lot of fellowships are done at Shankar Netralaya, LV Prasad and Arvind. So, but at least a lot of retina fellows who are completing their fellowship have experience with ICG. It's just that in the practice, probably they're doing a lot less. But then again, there are some key patients where you must keep in mind that this patient may need ICG in the future, like polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy, which is more common in India. These are patients where you may have to do photodynamic therapy later on. So these are cases where you may have to prime them from the beginning and be aware that these patients may need ICG angiography later on.